On behalf of council, I'd like to welcome everyone here to our service this afternoon. Also a special welcome to any guests who are joining us as well. This afternoon, we will be led by our own Reverend Feenstra. We pray that the Lord will give you all that you're in need of as well. There's no additional announcements, and we have our pre-service song, which is "This Is My Father's World."
Good afternoon, congregation. What a privilege we can be here again. We don't always think about that, but we're going to be looking at that this afternoon, that we need a mediator, that we are unholy people, and we come in the presence of a God who is described as a consuming fire. So the fact that we are here and that we're not consumed in his presence is only through Jesus Christ. Let's rise then if you are able. Dear brothers and sisters, where does our help come from?
Our help is in the name of the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth.
Receive God's greeting to you this afternoon. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Let's now sing together the words of Psalm 90, 1, 2, and 3. This is a psalm that Moses wrote. And so we'll be looking at Moses as mediator. So keep that in mind, too, that Moses was the one who first authored this psalm.
You have been since you shaped all creation.
Let's pray together. Dear Heavenly Father, we come before you, and as we sang in Psalm 90, we see that we are but a breath, and yet you are everlasting. Father, we confess that we often idolize ourselves. We think of ourselves very highly. We think we are a big deal, and yet a psalm like this humbles us. That our life is brief, and yet 1,000 of your years in your sight are like a day gone by. That you're from everlasting to everlasting, and as we come before you this afternoon, we can't even comprehend that. That you have always been there. That you are the one who even created time. And so we pray that you might teach us to number our days. Teach us to know ourselves and to know you. Now teach us then to marvel at your grace that you have, in your plan, made a way possible for us to dwell with you forever. That you are a God who desired to dwell with this people forever and ever. And so we pray that we might come before you once again with humility, but with overflowing gratitude and thankfulness. And we pray that you might open our hearts and our minds to your word. We pray that we might all the more be transformed by your word, all the more that we might desire to know the Christ of your word more. That more and more we cling to him who is our great deliverer, our great mediator. The one who brings us to you so we can have access to you and call you Abba. We pray that you might then work in us this afternoon through your Holy Spirit. Fill us with your grace, with your presence. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. I invite you to open your Bibles to Exodus. We'll be looking at Lord's Day 5, what we confess there this afternoon. And at the end of Lord's Day 5, we have the question that says, what kind of mediator must we seek? And so in this sermon, and the plan is in another one as well, we'll look at Moses as mediator and see how he pointed to Christ, and yet that he was insufficient, that another mediator was needed. So we'll read some from Exodus, where we see Moses functioning as a mediator between a holy God and unholy people. And the readings we'll read is Exodus 19 in the first place, but I'll be changing the Exodus 34 to 32 because there's so much here. I was writing the sermon, and it was getting really, really long, so I had to divide it in two. So we'll look at Exodus 19, verse 10. The first place, Exodus 19. The Lord said to Moses, go to the people and consecrate them today and tomorrow, and let them wash their garments, and be ready for the third day. For on the third day, the Lord will come down on Mount Sinai in the sight of all the people. And you shall set limits for the people all around, saying, take care not to go up into the mountain or touch the edge of it. Whoever touches the mountain shall be put to death. No hand shall touch him, but he shall be stoned or shot, whether beast or man, he shall not live. When the trumpet sounds a long blast, they shall come up to the mountain. So Moses went down from the mountain to the people and consecrated the people, and they washed their garments. And he said to the people, be ready for the third day, do not go near a woman. On the morning of the third day, there were thunders and lightning and a thick cloud on the mountain and a very loud trumpet blast, so that all the people in the camp trembled. Then Moses brought the people out of the camp to meet God, and they took their stand at the foot of the mountain. Now Mount Sinai was wrapped in smoke because the Lord had descended on it in fire. The smoke of it went up like the smoke of a kiln, and the whole mountain trembled greatly. And as the sound of the trumpet grew louder and louder, Moses spoke, and God answered him in thunder. The Lord came down on Mount Sinai to the top of the mountain. The Lord called Moses to the top of the mountain, and Moses went up. Let's turn a few chapters further to Exodus 32. Exodus 32, where you get here that Moses has only been up the mountain 40 days, and the people make for themselves a golden calf. And we get what the exchange between the Lord and Moses. So Exodus 32, verse 7. And the Lord said to Moses, "Go down, for your people, whom you have brought up out of the land of Egypt, have corrupted themselves. They have turned aside quickly out of the way that I commanded them. They have made for themselves a golden calf, and have worshipped it, and sacrificed to it, and said, 'These are your gods, O Israel, who brought you up out of the land of Egypt.' And the Lord said to Moses, 'I have seen this people, and behold, it's a stiff-necked people. Now therefore, let me alone, that my wrath may burn hot against them, and I may consume them, in order that I may make a great nation of you.' But Moses implored the Lord his God, and said, 'O Lord, why does your wrath burn hot against your people, whom you have brought out of the land of Egypt with great power and with a mighty hand? Why should the Egyptians say, with evil intent did he bring them out, to kill them in the mountains and to consume them from the face of the earth? Turn from your burning anger and relent from the disaster against your people. Remember Abram, Isaac, and Israel, your servants, to whom you swore by your own self and said to them, I will multiply your offspring as the stars of heaven. And all this land that I have promised I will give to your offspring, and they shall inherit forever.' And the Lord relented from the disaster that he had spoken of bringing on his people." And then moving to a few verses later, verse 30. So Moses, he goes down, then he comes back up. Verse 30, chapter 32. "The next day Moses said to the people, 'You have sinned a great sin, and now I will go up to the Lord. Perhaps I can make atonement for your sin.' So Moses returned to the Lord and said, 'Alas, this people has sinned a great sin. They have made for themselves gods of gold. But now, if you will forgive their sin, but if not, please blot me out of your book that you have written.' But the Lord said to Moses, 'Whoever has sinned against me, I will blot out of my book. But now go, lead the people to the place about which I have spoken to you. Behold, my angel shall go before you. Nevertheless, in the day when I visit, I will visit their sin upon them.' Then the Lord sent a plague on the people because they made the calf, the one that Aaron made." Let's sing together in response, once again from the same psalm, a prayer of Moses, the man of God, Psalm 95, 7, and 8. Let's now turn to our confession, the Heidelberg Catechism. We come this afternoon to the second part of the Catechism. The first part is our sin and misery. The second part then is our deliverance. We looked at last week, Lord's Day 4, that our sins deserve temporal and eternal punishment. And now the question is, how can we escape this? How can we be restored to favor with God? So Lord's Day 5, since according to God's righteous judgment, we deserve temporal and eternal punishment, how can we escape this punishment and be again received into favor? God demands that his justice be satisfied. Therefore, we must make full payment either by ourselves or through another. Can we by ourselves make this payment? Certainly not. On the contrary, we daily increase our debt. Can any mere creature pay for us? No, in the first place, God will not punish another creature for the sin which man has committed. Furthermore, no mere creature can sustain the burden of God's eternal wrath against sin and deliver others from it. What kind of mediator and deliverer must we seek? One who is a true and righteous man, and yet more powerful than all creatures, that is one who is at the same time true God. Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, how many of you know what a mediator is? We just read that word. What kind of mediator, deliverer must we seek? How many of you can define what a mediator is? Well, a mediator is someone who is a go-between, someone who reconciles two different people or two parties who are at odds with each other. A mediator, in a way, you could say, stands in the gap and brings them together for reconciliation. A mediator is the go-between. Mediators are used still a lot today. If you search in your Google need for a mediator, you come across several different sites offering services of a mediator to resolve conflicts in marriage or in family situation or in churches, other things. A mediator is a go-between. A mediator is someone who can take one party and the other party and bring them together when they've been at odds with each other. And the thing is, this should be a very precious word to us all. Because we are only here as unholy people, people who struggle with sin. We are only here in the presence of a holy God, hearing him through his word. Here in the presence of the Spirit, we're only here because of a mediator. It's only possible that we're here and that we're not consumed by God who is everlastingly holy, because we have a mediator. We have a go-between. We have someone who stands in the gap. God, in his grace, provides us with a mediator. Read about that in 1 Timothy 2. There's one mediator between God and man, the man Jesus Christ. We have a mediator. But what's beautiful about Scripture, and I hope more and more as you read your Bibles, you see this. What's beautiful about Scripture is that what we see come to fulfillment in Jesus Christ already has pictures and shadows in the Old Testament. The Old Testament, you see God in a way, he's telling the story that is going to come in its full splendor, in its full gloriousness in Jesus Christ. And so in the Old Testament, he gives us previews, if you will. He gives us pictures. He gives us shadows that all point to Jesus Christ. It's a wonderful thing when you see the Bible this way. And one of those things that we see is that God already gives shadows, hints of the mediator, Jesus Christ. You can read about different mediators in the Old Testament, but one mediator we read about, we see this very vividly, is Moses. And so this afternoon, I'm going to look at Moses, especially at Mount Sinai, how he's a mediator between God, who is a consuming fire, God who's so holy, and the people who are unholy. And I hope to, in another sermon in the next afternoon, to expand on this a bit and see just how beautiful it is how Moses is a mediator and how he points, how he foreshadows Jesus Christ. And so we see that today more broadly with the events at Mount Sinai. So Mount Sinai, if you're familiar with the story, you know that the Israelites had been in bondage in Egypt. They were in slavery. They had been there many, many years. There seemed to be no hope. They were stuck in their slavery. Pharaoh was so powerful, no one could possibly pull them out of his power. But God, in his grace, he comes down, and through Moses, he delivers his people. He delivers them, he brings them out of Egypt, and he brings them into the wilderness. And in the wilderness, God is going to show them who he is. He's going to show them what kind of a God he is. And you see this come to a beautiful fullness at Mount Sinai. God shows the Israelites how holy he is at Mount Sinai. But as you read through these events, and I encourage you this week, if you can, to read through Exodus 19 and 20 and Exodus 24, and then towards the end, I can maybe put it out on church social, but I encourage you to read these events. As you read them, you see more and more that there is this great canyon between God and the people. God, who is being revealed more and more of how holy he is, and the people, as you're seeing, how unholy they are. You see the sin of the people more clearly in light of God in his holiness as he showcases that at Mount Sinai. And so in the first place, you see the unholiness of the people. You read in a couple places in Exodus, Exodus 19, Exodus 24, that when they hear the law of God, they say, everything God has said, we're going to do. All that he has said, we will do. Yep, we got this. And then you read the sad story that Moses is only on the mountain for 40 days, a little over a month, and they grow impatient. And they say to Aaron, let's make ourselves an idol. You see the unholiness of the people. They had just heard God's law, Exodus 20, spoken by God himself. They heard the command, you shall not make for yourself idols. And after they heard God's voice speaking from the mountain, they were even so shaken that they said to Moses, you speak to us, but don't let God speak to us, lest we die. That's in Exodus 20. So they just heard that, and yet 40 days later, they forget. 40 days later, they're blatantly breaking the commandment. You shall not make for yourselves an idol. And so they make for themselves a golden calf. It's important to know that there was a god in Egypt that was depicted as a young bull. So you see here that the Israelites, they're still devoted to these gods that they were supposed to leave behind. You know, they might have been brought out of Egypt, but Egypt was still in their heart. In their heart, they were still devoted to the idols of Egypt. And so you get Israel depicted as unholy, and then you get the holiness of God on display. Turn with me to a few passages to see this for yourself. We read some of these, but Exodus 19. And I pray that the Spirit might give us insight and that we see how holy God is here and that we are trembling like the Israelites. So Exodus 19 in the first place, you get the displays of God's holiness. So Exodus 19, it's page 60 in the Pew Bible, verse 18 and 19. We read those words already, but read them again. Now Mount Sinai was wrapped in smoke because the Lord had descended on it in fire. The smoke of it went up like the smoke of a kiln, and the whole mountain trembled greatly. And as the sound of the trumpet grew louder and louder, Moses spoke, and God answered him in thunder. So you get God descending on this mountain. There's fire. There's loud trumpet sounds. There's thundering. The mountain itself is shaking as God is descending on it. And then 24, you get another picture. If you turn to chapter 24, verse 17. Exodus 24, verse 17. Now the appearance of the glory of the Lord was like a devouring fire on the top of the mountain in the sight of the people of Israel. God's presence is like a consuming and devouring fire. And so you get this displays of God's holiness, and then you read that God needs to protect the people from their holiness. So turn back to chapter 19, verse 11 and 12. So you get displays of God's holiness, and then you see in several passages God protecting them from his holiness. So 19, verse 11, and be ready for the third day, for on the third day the Lord will come down on Mount Sinai in the sight of all the people. And you shall set limits for the people all around, saying, take care not to go up into the mountain or touch the edge of it. Whoever touches the mountain shall be put to death. And then a few verses later, 21 of chapter 19, the Lord said to Moses, go down and warn the people, lest they break through to the Lord to look and many of them perish. And then you get Moses says to the Lord, verse 23, well, we've already set limits, so they can't break through. And then verse 24, God repeats again. He says to Moses, go down and come up bringing Aaron with you, but do not let the priests and the people break through to come up to the Lord, lest he break out against them. And this theme is repeated later in Exodus, Exodus 30. See, God protecting the people from his holiness. Exodus 33, if you look with me there, verse 3. This is after the incident of the golden calf. Moses is conversing with God, and God says he's not going to go up with the people anymore because of their unholiness. So 33, verse 3, he says, go up to a land flowing with milk and honey, but I will not go up among you, lest I consume you on the way, for you are a stiff-necked people. And then in verse 5, he repeats, in case we missed it, for the Lord had said to Moses, say to the people of Israel, you are a stiff-necked people. If for a single moment I should go up among you, I will consume you. We have to understand what God is saying here in these passages, why he's putting these limits around the mountain, why he's saying to Moses, well, I can't go up with you, lest I consume you. God, what he's saying here is that he needs to protect the people from himself. He needs to protect the people from his holiness because his holiness is so consuming, so brilliant, so radiant that it cannot but consume unholiness and sin and defilement. When God says set limits, it's not that God is being exclusive or antisocial. He's saying set these limits here because you are an unholy people and I am such a holy God and I need to protect you from myself because I'm a God of consuming fire. I'm a God of brilliant, radiant holiness. Unholy people cannot dwell with me. You know, if you read these chapters, I encourage you again, read these chapters on your own. I guarantee you that every single one of us here has far too low of a view of God's holiness. I know my view of God's holiness is far too low. God is so holy that he cannot but consume anything that is impure in his presence. It's why he's described chapter 24, verse 17, as a consuming fire on the mountain. How many of you right now, in your mind's eye, can picture a blazing fire? Maybe it was a fire that was a bonfire that got a bit out of hand. It was a huge, raging fire. Or maybe you've seen pictures or watched videos of forest fires. You can probably picture now that even as you were far away, even as you stood several meters back, you could feel the heat of that fire. Well, do you know that you could more likely walk into a raging fire and come out unharmed than you can walk into the presence of God without a mediator? More likely walk into a raging fire and come out unharmed than go near God without a mediator. You know, we might find these chapters hard in Exodus. We read about God who is about to destroy the people when we read about the plagues that he sends. When we read later in the events of Israel's history, how the sons of Aaron are consumed by fire as they offer unauthorized fire. As we read about Uzzah, if you remember that story where the ark is on a cart with oxen and the oxen stumble, Uzzah touches it to make sure it doesn't fall, and he's consumed. And you read these stories and you say, "That how can this be? It's God fair here." But if we are asking these questions, we haven't understood God's holiness. We haven't understand how intense his holiness, how pure it is, how flawless it is, that it's like a mighty consuming fire. You know, we don't tell a fire that it's unfair that it burns so hot. That it's unfair that when we put our hand in the fire, we get hurt. I don't think any of us here has said to a fire, "That's not fair." God's holiness is like a consuming fire. And so as you think about these events, think about the events of Sinai. You got God on the one side, who's holy, holy, holy. God who's so holy that mighty angels, the seraphim, who have never sinned, still cover their eyes, their faces in the presence of God. You get a God who's so holy on this side, and then you get the Israelites on the other. And you see the dilemma. That's the dilemma we're meant to see as we read Exodus. How can a holy God dwell with unholy people? How is that possible? It's the dilemma we read about in Lord's Day 5 as well. How can those who deserve punishment, who are unholy, who are sinful, how can they possibly be received into favor? It's the dilemma described powerfully in Isaiah 33. Isaiah 33, we read, "The sinners in Zion are terrified. They say, 'Who among us can dwell with everlasting fire? Who among us can dwell with consuming burning?'" It's the dilemma you see in the Old Testament. Holy God, unholy people. How can they be reconciled? When you think about this in our own lives, as we're here this afternoon, who among us, if you think about this, who among us can dwell with consuming fire? By nature, we're sinners. Think about yourself. Think about ourselves outside of the grace of God, outside of the regenerating work of the Spirit. We, by nature, what we bring to the table are no better than Israel. It's very tempting as we read these passages to be hard on Israel and say, "Oh man, we're no better by nature. We didn't come out of the womb somehow more sanctified than Israel." How often can we think that as we look to ourselves that, you know, maybe we're not that bad. Maybe we can approach God in ourselves. As we think through the Ten Commandments and we think, well, I haven't been doing them perfectly, but I'm better than so-and-so, or, you know, I'm not that bad. Not perfect, but I'm not that bad. The problem is that we often look horizontally. We look at others. We compare ourselves to others. Instead of looking vertically, instead of understanding who God is in his holiness. You know, maybe this analogy helps, maybe it doesn't, but picture one candle flickering a little bit, comparing itself, if candles could talk, to another candle and saying, "Oh, I'm a bit brighter than that candle." Picture one candle comparing itself to another when the standard is the sun, the noonday sun. God is so holy. We might look all right on the outside, but God's holy eyes gaze inward. We might not be building golden calves in our church or in our homes. I don't think there's anyone here who has a golden calf in their house. But are we building idols in our hearts? You know, the idols of Egypt, the idols of this world captivated Israel. What is captivating your heart? Is God enthroned in your heart? Is he first, ever, and always? Think about this. Even there's harmless things we might see in themselves, but these things, even good things that are absorbing us, things that are our priority, things that we have put higher on our list of priorities than God. Who is sitting enthroned in your heart? And know that God's holy eyes are not deceived. I can't see into your heart. You can't see into my heart. But God, the one we see as he comes in splendor and glory on Mount Sinai, he sees into the depths of our soul. His holy eyes gaze at us, and he knows us fully. So how can we stand? How can we come before God? How can we come before him and have the confidence to even say, Abba? Well, as you see already in the Old Testament, it's only through a mediator. We see Moses, he fulfills this role as mediator. If you read through chapter 19 and following, you read, I think it's at least 7 or 8 times that we read that Moses went up the mountain and Moses went down the mountain. Moses went up and down. Chapter 19, if you read that chapter later, count how many times we read that Moses went up and he went back down. He's the go-between. He's the mediator. He's the one bridging the gap between an infinitely holy God and unholy people. And he's the one who stands before God as mediator when the people sin. You know, we read that in chapter 32, the people, they make this this calf, and then God says, now therefore, let me alone, Moses, 32 verse 10, that my wrath may burn hot against them, that I might consume them. And then we read that Moses implores the Lord, 32 verse 11. He falls on his knees. He prays for the people. It's described elsewhere in Deuteronomy 9. Moses, he says there, I fell prostrate before the Lord for 40 days and 40 nights. I ate no bread and drank no water because of all the sin you committed. But again, the Lord listened to me. Moses stands in the gap. He's the one who says, who is the mediator imploring God to be reconciled to the people. And he goes so far even to offer his own life. 32 verse 30. Let's look at that verse again. 32 verse 30 and following. 32 verse 30. You see Moses has a wonderful mediator here. Exodus 32 verse 30. The next day Moses said to the people, you have sinned a great sin. And now I will go up to the Lord. Perhaps I can make atonement for your sin. In verse 31, so Moses returned to the Lord and said, alas, this people has sinned a great sin. They have made for themselves gods of gold. But now, if you will forgive their sin, but if not, please blot me out of your book that you have written. This should send shivers down our spines when we see the love of Moses for the people. He says, forgive them, Father. Forgive them, Yahweh. But if not, then take me. Blot me out of your book of life. Erase my name from among the list of those who are in your kingdom. Blot me out of your book so that these people might live. And these Israelites, they weren't so lovable. You read in the previous chapters that they were grumbling against Moses. They were bitter. They were angry. In Exodus 17, you read that they even wanted to stone Moses. They wanted to kill him. Don't you think Moses, you'd say that's understandable if he said, yes, God, destroy them. These people don't respect me at all. These people, they're trying to even kill me. Destroy them in your wrath. And yet Moses, he stands between God and the people, and he says, blot me out. We see the love of the mediator for the people. And yet we read that there's a need for a greater mediator because the Lord says to Moses, verse 33, whoever has sinned against me, I will blot out of my book. And then later, verse 35, he sends a plague on the people. We see in here that Moses is an imperfect mediator. He himself was a sinner. He could not himself bear the wrath of God, the holy consuming fire of God's holiness. There's need for a greater mediator to come. There's need for one, as we read in Hebrews 12, who is the mediator of the new covenant, who stands between holy God and unholy people. There's need here for one who will ascend the Mount of Golgotha. The one who would come and say, Father, blot me out. Erase my name from the book of life. Take me. Pour out your wrath on me. May your holy fire come upon me so that these people might be forgiven forever. My people. There's need for a mediator who would stand between us and the flames of the consuming fire of God's holiness. And he would be consumed. You read in Lamentations 1, from on high he sent fire. Into my bones he made it descend. This mediator coming, who Moses pointed to, would know and experience the wrath of God in every fiber of his mind, body, and soul. From on high he sent fire into my bones. He made it descend. A mediator who would stand in the breach for us. A mediator whose name is Jesus. All the consuming holiness of God would fall on him so that we are totally protected. Falling on him because he's wearing our sin. 2 Corinthians 5, we read, he who knew no sin was made to be sin. Think about the humility of Jesus Christ, the one who is the image of God, the one who is the Son of God, the one who is God of very God, the one who himself is a consuming fire. He wraps himself in our shame and our guilt. The one who knew no sin is made to be sin. He goes to the cross wearing your and my sins upon himself. As if he had committed them. Think about all those thoughts you've had, those sinful thoughts. Well, God transfers them to your mediator as if he had those thoughts. Think of those careless words you have spoken, those bitter words, those angry words, those hurtful words. Jesus was treated as if he had said those words. Think about the pride in your heart or the lustful glances you've had. Or the idolatry lurking deep in your heart. Jesus was treated as if that was his sin. Peter says, 1 Peter 2, he himself bore our sins. He bore all of your sins, all of those sinful thoughts, words, and actions, as if he had committed them. He who knew no sin was made to be sin, wrapped in your shame and sin, and bearing the penalty. And he did this for people like you and me, who don't deserve it. You know, Moses, he stands between God and the people and says, blot me out. Moses shows his love for people who certainly didn't deserve it. People who wanted to stone him. And yet his love was just a glimpse of the far surpassing love of Jesus Christ. Romans 5, you read about this. For at just the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous man. But God demonstrated his own love for us in this, that while we were sinners, God, or Christ, died for us. While we were sinners, while we were ungodly, while we were running hard after our idols and turning our back on God, like petulant children kicking against God, wanting to go our own way, wanting to do our own will. And Jesus, he stands in the gap and he says, Father, blot me out. Erase my name from the book of life. so that theirs might be chiseled in stone, so that they might forever have a place with you. As we think about our mediator, brothers and sisters, as we go from here, I pray that the Spirit might show you the depths of Christ's love. As you see the shadows of his love and his sacrifice all over the events of Mount Sinai. Are you right now feeling like a sinner? Feeling like there's no way you can come into the presence of a holy God? Come to the one who stands in the breach, the one who leads you by hand, by your hand, takes you out of your sin and shame, and brings you to the very throne room and face of God. Come to him and see how much every day you need him. You need your great mediator standing between you and God and bringing you to him. Amen. Let's sing in response, in Christ alone. Only through him can we approach our Heavenly Father. Let's now confess together what we believe as we confess the words of the Apostles' Creed, and we'll do that singing hymn one. In our afternoon prayer, we'll pray for Sean and Hannah Campin, who welcomed, I think it was a week and a bit ago, but welcomed a healthy baby girl, Gwen. Also pray for Dr. Vischer, who was hospitalized recently, and it seems like he suffered a stroke. He'll be there for a few days, so we'll pray for him and Teenie. We'll also pray for Pastor John, as he deliberates the call to Grassy, and I encourage you also to reach out to him and to urge him to stay, otherwise I'll be lost. So let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we say those words so often, calling you Father. And as we read the events of Mount Sinai and what happened there, and as we see your holiness on display, as we see our unholiness in Israel, how this astounds us, and yet not nearly enough, we confess. That we can have access to you through our mediator. As we read in Hebrews, that we can enter into the most holy place by the blood of Jesus. That we can draw near to you. And that there's a day coming that we will gaze on your face. That we will see you face to face, as we read in Revelation. Father, we thank you for your plan and how wise you are. That you, your purpose, wanted to dwell with us. And we see that all throughout Scripture, that your plan is to dwell with us, to put your temple in our midst. How amazing it is as we see that come to fulfillment, the Holy Spirit dwelling in our hearts. We have holy God dwelling within us. You desire to not just be near us, not just to be with us, but to be in us. We pray that we might understand this more. We pray that you might open hard hearts. We know that you are the one who can do that. We pray that we might draw near to our mediator and draw near to you through him. We pray that we might grow in awe and wonder of his love for us, that while we were sinners, while we were enemies, while we were each going our own way, that he died for us. That he was willing to suffer the eternity of wrath, willing to be blotted out from the book of the living so that we might have eternal life. We pray that we might be humble. We pray that we might grow in our love for you and for one another. That we see that it's only by your grace that we stand before you. That we see that we are no better than anyone beside us, than anyone else in our church. And we might have conflicts with family members or with fellow brothers and sisters in Christ. And yet help us to look beyond those two to the fact that none of us here is worthy of your grace. That none of us can enter into your presence, you who are the consuming fire. None of us can do this but only through Jesus Christ. None of us were so lovable in ourselves, and yet Christ set his love on us. We pray then that you be with us as church, that we are a church devoted to one another, loving one another, caring for one another, urging one another to look to our mediator and our great deliverer. We pray that you be with those among us who are rejoicing. We ask that you might work in us, that we rejoice with those who rejoice. We pray that you be with Sean and Hannah. They've welcomed a baby girl into their family, Gwen. We pray that you be with this little one. We pray that she might grow up to know that you have put your name on her forehead, that you have claimed her, and that she might then claim you. We pray that you be with Sean and Hannah as they raise her to know her Savior. We pray that you be with Dr. Vischer. We pray that you be with him right now as he is in the hospital, that you give him strength and comfort. We pray that you be with Teenie. She's a support to him, that you give her the comfort and the strength from Jesus Christ. We also pray that you be with Dr. Vischer as the disappointment that he had plans to go to Namibia. I see that you might comfort him in this too and know that he is in your hands. We pray that you be with our Pastor John as he deliberates the call to Grassy. Fill him with wisdom and insight. And we pray that you be with Annette and children as well. This affects them deeply also. We pray that you surround them with your wisdom, with your strength. Be with us as church too, that we might show our appreciation for Pastor John. We pray that you be with all of our leaders here, be with the elders, the deacons. Watch over us all. We pray that you be with us as we go from here, as we go into a new week, as we're faced with challenges, with doubts, with temptations, as we can easily slide from your ways, as we can, like Israel, forget what you have done. And so remind us, give us the strength of the Holy Spirit to get through this new week. We bring all this before you only through our great mediator and high priest, Jesus Christ. Amen. We now have an opportunity to show our thankfulness for what God has done for us in providing us with a mediator. And after the offering, we'll sing hymn 54, which is also the words of Psalm 90, put in a bit of different words. So we started with Psalm 90, we'll end with Psalm 90 in the words of hymn 54, and then we'll close with hymn 8. Thank you. Dear brothers and sisters, go into this week with God's blessing ringing in your ears. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen.